Good evening. Thank you all for your time this evening. This is the second public meeting for the schematic design process for the Congress Square Redesign and Public Art Commission. My name is Caitlin Cameron. I'm the urban designer for the city of Portland and the project manager for this project. The project partners for this project are the city of Portland, but we also have the Public Art Committee and Friends of Congress Square Park. And several representatives from those groups are here this evening. I don't know if you want to identify yourselves or not, but I also want to thank the Westin Hotel for generously hosting us this evening. And also thank you to CTN for filming this evening. I'm just going to go over a couple of announcements and then we'll get right to the presentation. So, I guess the first announcement is that artist Sarah Z is stuck on a plane at the moment. So she will be here, but we're sort of not sure when. So it might be quite late towards the end of the meeting. We apologize for that. We're just going to have to keep you posted about that status. We do have someone from her studio here, David Ramirez, who will present in her place if it comes to that. So just some background information. Right now, the Congress Square project is in the schematic design phase. That means at the end of spring, we will have design concepts for the square and the public artwork. And at that point, there'll sort of be a pause in the design process while the project partners begin fundraising to be able to then implement the project. I just have one note that you'll see that we have a roadway layout that we're showing in the design concepts that we've been using for the project, but that's still under review and isn't completely finalized, and we're working with the Maine Department of Transportation and Sebago Technics to work on that piece of the project. But we're not going to focus on the road layout, meaning like the traffic patterns, the curb, and that kind of thing tonight. The agenda for this evening: first, WRT, the design team, will present, and then we'll have time for questions and feedback. And whenever Sarah arrives, then we'll present the public art aspect of the project. But we're especially interested in getting feedback and hearing questions from you. So we will have time to do that this evening. We also have index cards at the back of the room. If you feel more comfortable just writing something down, you can leave it at that table back there and we'll collect them. We're also going to post the presentations online, and there'll be an online form where you can also give feedback. So there are different ways that you can tell us what you think. And I'm going to have the online feedback through the next month until January 15th. We're also going to be presenting, or I'm going to be presenting tonight's presentation at many different boards: the Parks Commission, the Land Bank Commission, the Planning Board, the Historic Preservation Board. So you can also come to those, or if someone you know couldn't make it this evening, they could come to one of those presentations as well.
Hi everyone. How are you guys? We didn't bring in this cold with us, so I hope it's clear that. And there are a couple of seats, there are two in the front side, so if there are folks doesn't have the seat, please have a seat and relax and kind of go through the presentation. And I'm here, I'm Keiko Kramer from WRT design team. And I'm here with Misa Chen, as well as Patrick Kreener. And so we're gonna run through the show at the beginning for the site design, which is we have a public presentation workshop back in December. October, we have a 3 days process engaging to the public and sort of coming up idea with people actually use the park, and that's most important part for our process. And we did back then in October, coming up some idea, do the sketch there, programming and voice, and get the all information, bring back to for a while, and we come up with sort of the in progress scheme to present today. And it's still progress, but we want to kind of share the where we are and sort of how we sort of engage the voice we taken from the last workshop, and hopefully we can have more voice to hearing today.
In terms of the vision, what we want from this Congress Square, it needs to be accessible, inviting, year-round. I'm not going to read through the text, but you can see that all these keywords we want to capture throughout the whole process, which is not going to be changed. Quickly, a project review Caitlin mentioned earlier. In terms of where we are right now, you can see we're kind of halfway through this public engagement process. The design definitely is not done yet. This is almost like today will be kind of the first review process to show where we are, and next checkpoint will be sometime in February. And so the city will keep you guys posted when we will be back in that middle of the winter time there. And the schematic design will be completed sometime in the mid-March or the spring, as we say. And so please do give us any feedback, comments you have as we progress the design. Quickly, to kind of remind ourselves as well, where is Congress Square and how it relates to the surrounding neighborhood and the context, you see that it's almost like a halfway between the Longfellow Square, Longfellow Square, and to the Monument Square. And what is this node, the relationship to these two significant open space? From the October workshop, here will be a couple of slides. I kind of just want to quickly go through with you guys because some people might not participate last round. So this is some of like a quick summary to capture what was discussed there. We talk about the shade studies, how the shade will affect the program usage. In the summertime, people want to be shaded in a way, but then in the wintertime, people want to get as much sun exposure possible. So that can be achieved by the tree canopies or how you lay out a seating in relation to the trees and surrounding buildings, and that all can give it a variety of the different experience within the Congress Square here.
So, this is the winter, this is the summer, and 8 a.m., noon, and 4 p.m. So you can see how do the shadows transition around to the park and square.
The next one here, we look into the pedestrian crossing here, really just to identify how many points we have to go through in order to get to from one side to the other side, from one side of Congress Street to the other side, or the High Street here. The red arrowhead here really just to indicate the existing condition, these mini islands between the two sides of the intersection. And then so one of our challenges is really how to use this redesign opportunity to make the intersection more of an integrated design and to ease and put the pedestrian crossing experience as a priority. Another character that we look into actually is the visual character. We recognize that there are already so many nice historical architecture facades surrounding the project site. However, the current design not really support in order for people to appreciate what we already have. So one of the things that for this redesigned Congress Square we wanted to make sure is that you give people a moment that they can stop, pause, and look up the sky, and they realize that there are so many beautiful buildings surrounding the square and surrounding here. So this is to identify some of the opportunity, and also you can see from the Western Hotel how that wall can in relation to the art museum here.
So back in October, we actually walked through the site with a couple of beautiful people to just kind of experience and actually what we see. Also the people told us what is important for them. So that's how we're kind of recognizing and raising what is on the site.
The spot elevation, or in a way, is how the height elevation changes within the Congress Square Park or move around the intersection. And we recognize that particularly within the Congress Square Park, there are some existing steps, which there are definitely pros and cons. You give people a sense of protection in a way that you change the protection, but also it's not accessible. One of the goal really for this Congress Square, we wanted to make sure the design is inclusive, it's accessible, so that people, whether they're on wheelchair, on they're pushing a stroller, or they are just little ones jumping around, walking around faster than anybody else. We want to make sure everybody use the park in the same access way, same way to meet, they can enter the park the same way. So in the following presentation, you will begin to see how we really try to manipulate the elevation in order to provide the accessible route here. So at the kind of in the before we start to develop the concept sketch during the October workshop, we arrive at the three kind of thematic approach here and capture the word, like keywords or comments or voice we heard from the workshop. Some of the important aspects for the accessibility, connectivity, and identity. Accessibility, we want to make sure that the Congress Square is an inclusive environment. They have the better defined pathway for people to move around the space. For the connectivity, we wanted to see the Congress Square as a unified space and you know how to achieve that there throughout different design components. And also that the access point can be more of a clearly defined. Again, in the following presentation, you will start to see how that connectivity starts to reveal. For the identity, there's a different way really to reinforce the identity of the Congress Square. In a way, the overall Congress Square design or the site design is part of to giving that Congress Square the identity. So throughout the site design, throughout the selection of the planting, they all can be part of identity. Also another aspect that particularly mentioned is the artwork, and also that so that will be kind of shared a little bit more in depth from the Z Studio in the following presentation here. So that this is also from October workshop, we arrived to the preliminary concept, what defines a Congress Square, how people feel like they're arriving Congress Square or they're in Congress Square. So there are two levels of experience. As you can see, more of the blue outline is where people are arriving the Congress Square. For the next level of the light orange here is people feel like they're in Congress Square. So there are different way to kind of acknowledge the sense of arrival. But the interesting part that we just want to kind of pick it up is that the Congress Square is not a square, as you can see. It's really reached out to, you know, different certain. So then we shouldn't constrain ourselves, feel like Congress Square is really right at the intersection. It's a square there. It's really reaching out to the neighborhood. And you should recognize the neighborhood, different characters, and the surrounding environments as well.
Yeah, and what tells this sort of, the, as Misa said, the square is not square. That's what that means. Like, it's going to be the critical of having the elements and materials and how we're going to give the sense of arrival. So that's going to be tied back into the how we would like to approach the sense of arrival and journey to when it comes in and feels like, oh, we are in a Congress Square, maybe, and going through, identifying, oh yes, I'm in the Congress Square in this intersection. And that's sort of the identifying how we'd like to approach to the site design.
So here is a series of layers, as you probably remember from the last October workshop, it's kind of the peeling the onions that we call. So that you start to, this is really to analyze how people move through the site. Definitely this is not identify every possibility. As we joke about, people might go all directions either way, but we recognize more of the priority, how people will move through or around, not only the park, but then within the Congress Square here, and how you started to incorporate the greenery tied to the movement area so that it starts to expand from the movement line, and we call it as a green fabric. It's not fabric, but it's part of that urban fabric that we try to tie back in and introduce this greenery and as like a green node, introduce the Congress Square as a green node along people's movement. And the next layer is in terms of how you start to introduce the social pocket or the seating arrangement, the tree canopies, and that will dictate kind of, it's together how, where you're gonna locate the seat and where the tree canopies will come in. And so from there, for tonight, really, we wanted to make sure that when we're starting to reveal this kind of the baby step of the conceptual site plan, It meets these aspects, the circulation, the accessibility, the space planning, and the programs activities, how this space can really, the Congress Square can accommodate different type of events, activities, and programs. So here is a kind of quick overview of the current concept site plan. Some major site components here, we called it out in terms of where it's possibility that we can store the site furniture or some equipment for the movie screening and the dance floor, which is number 9 there. We recognize that there's a need for the people, the staff people, they have the easy access to store the equipment, but same time we want to make sure that that volume will be part of the site design. So we want to consider that part of the component as early as possible, so we are not adding on later on, say, because we need it, we bring it in. We want to make sure it is considered throughout the process.
So when you look at this site, there's something missing. Something disappeared from current site. I don't know if anyone can tell me what it changed. That was an expected reaction.
The slipway.
Yes, crop is so, yes. But there's something around here.
Mm-hmm. The steps.
Yes. So that's the big thing. We take up the steps. Because we want to provide inclusive accessibility for everyone. And luckily, the site has the potential already to doesn't have to have steps. So that's a big thing. We approached how we can play with, like Misa said, manipulate those topography to create the universal, approachable space for everyone.
There will be some snapshot just to give you guys a sense of when we talk about that change of elevation. So in a way that you probably don't want to think about these sort of ramps or any like slopes, because as we say, it's under 5%, it's just a change of the surface. Now, you walk around it, sometimes the sidewalk could be, you know, from more like a technical talking, you will say, oh, 2%, 5%, everything under 5% we will consider it as accessible route. So in a way, we kind of use that to mitigate the change of elevation, but also that will give you a little bit different, like an experience within the park as well. So it's not...
Make sure you're talking into the microphone.
Okay. Sorry, I thought I was shouting, but actually it's not. Okay. So here, I think that, as Keiko pointed out, and which is really important, in the following presentation, you can get a little bit more in-depth in terms of how people can move around the site. So here, just give you an overview, and we will go through kind of quickly in terms of different design components here in the following presentation. We start to peel out this just to see the layers of the site plan we have, because when we compose everything together, you always forget about how many things that is piling up in order to compose that one plan. You can see like the first one from the very left, the roadway alignment, and then on top of it, you have the green islands, as we call. That's how where the green fabric blend into the Congress Square. Also the seating and space planning and the canopy. So when you put all these layers together, it becomes a Congress Square. And here we'll start to see a little bit more. For the circulation and accessibility, again, that is really almost like the priority. We wanted to make sure people move through the Congress Square or within the park, how people can really enjoy it without going through the steps there, as minimal as possible. So the major, like a thicker line really, you know, indicate the major movement, how people will pass through or go around the Congress Square Park and Congress Square. You see a circle there, kind of close to the cafe entrance to the Western Hotel. That is the only spot that so far we recognize might need steps in order to achieve to get you from the elevation there up to the stage, which is back in the corner there. That is where we have the steps, but in one way is that they get you quickly to get through from one elevation plan to the stage. The stage only 30 inch higher than the front open space here.
So we're not talking about people to have to hike through like a, you know, 10 plus steps.
So basically the pink line we're representing here is accessible route. The people can go through between a planting and the meander and a journey, or straight path, and you can just walk through path and don't even need to come into the park, or you can come in and walking through. So all pink line except that white dot at the top for the service access purpose, you can access everywhere on the top of the stage or in front of the stage or on the sidewalk, or everyone acts the same way.
Here are some snapshots just to give you the sense of how people can move through the site. As you can see that we're talking about if you're gonna get to, you know, from the Congress Street, turn around from getting to the residence doorway here, that is definitely accessible. There's no ramp or surface here. There's a change of elevation. Pulling down to come into this flat space, but in general, as you can see, is that we're trying to minimize the steps, the use of the steps, as much as possible. Here's another snapshot. Probably will give you better sense. You don't have to register a number. We just want to make sure we checked.
So this is the corner. Mm-hmm. This is the hotel where we are right now, and they're different from here to there. It's almost 4 feet different. But in between to creating those topography and sort of sloped surface, you can be able to go and journey to every level without having the steps. And what it does is those planting fabric is mitigate those gaps. But the going through in between planting, you are able to go down to the different level.
From there, another important task is we want to make sure the site plan can accommodate different type of programs. And here is really we start to identify the activities to be accommodated and what elements can be associated with these activities. This is also part of the visioning process that city conducted years ago. So we want to use it as a guideline since we already heard from the community back then. That should be something we should kind of use as a guidance to move forward when we think about how the space can accommodate different kind of activities here. So from here, just to point out that the activity we heard that these are from the top to down are more from the most desired to the maybe top five or top four most desirable ones. So then here you can see the access to the green space, to food and eating, performance, music, or art, events, smaller events, the first Friday artwork, the markets, the art craft show, or the play and education, which is to the all ages. So here in the following slides, you will start to see how the site plan can support and accommodate these activities here. So let's start from the food and eating. When last time in the workshop, we identified where would be the potential kind of parking spot as a temporary area for the food truck to park, and that start to kind of provide access for people access to the food truck here. So the dotted line here just to indicate the potential area we can do for the food truck to park there, or right. So or if the park curb design allowed it, the park because we. Know that previously there was food trucks actually went into the Congress Square Park, and then people can enjoy that out like, around the food truck here, and which it could be at more of the temporary, like over the weekend or special events, but we want to make sure that the space can accommodate that's different a variety of the food truck situation here. For the circle dock here, we were also talking about, you know, it would be nice maybe that we can have some snack coffee van. It doesn't have to be big. It could be almost like an ice cream car, something like that. But depends on the season, depends on the event. There are certain settings that will accommodate these type of food trucks or the snack coffee van to be on site. Here are a couple examples, like the first one, as I mentioned earlier, you can start to have the food truck come into the plaza and people can sit around the movable tables and chairs here. Or in the middle, you see the example from San Francisco. They are utilizing existing parking spots. So the van is really a regular size of it. But then they open up, people start to gather with the around it. And the last one is more of an extensive version of it, which, you know, you would allow like almost the food truck park at the Congress and High Street, and then that really surround the plaza and for people to have more of the extensive food experience in a way.
So as Misa mentioned, the left side of photo is obviously what's happening right now. And in the process in the workshop, what we also want to make sure is what's happening there and people enjoying it, we make sure that we can do the same things to accommodate and then adding on to more programming activities. So that's the way kind of we proceed the programming.
For the performance, we look into how the Congress Square can accommodate different venue in terms of from the music performance, which we have certain music venue are really popular right now happening on the in the Congress Square Park. Also the art performance, the street performing, movie screening, projection on buildings, or outdoor museum at PMA, the museum here. So that you will see as the two walls from one side at the west end or the other side at the facade of the museum. Here we have the opportunity to utilize them as a projection. So not only for say the seasonal or holiday a projection, that could be something for even like a digital image moving things as a utilize this two wall for that space. For the movie screening, in a way that we can start to utilize the stage area there and allow actually a deeper space that people can enjoy the movie screening there. And for the music performance, really the main stage is right at that corner you see. But then we also found a couple other spots will be really nice with the planting surrounding and the seat wall around it. It provides a different view of how the performers go and how people really view the performing. So in a way, if the performing on the stage, you know, people look into the corner, or if the performing is right more of the adults down here, then people start to see more of like the city and different buildings as a background. So it's just different type of experience for the music performers here. Couple example, and again, we try to make sure we capture what are already good and popular within the Congress Square Park. We have the music performance, and that is sort of our performance is sort of like they, you know, a different kind of activity, and that is not necessarily can just be on the stage. If we have a certain setting for this type of different performance, we want to make sure that people can find their spot and doing the performance there. In the middle, that's a kind of example how you can utilize the exterior wall, not only for the pattern or lighting projection, but you can also do a music concert or something projection to the wall as well. Events, there are day-to-day events, there are special events. First, we look into really most important thing for people all around here. We use the park every day. So how really this space can accommodate a variety of activities, the list can go longer than that. And then we found that these are more of the top people most wanted to do on daily basis thing here. People want to do people watching, gather, social, poetry reading, lunch break, educational learning, play, small events. And small events here happening could be yoga, Tai Chi classes. So all different bubbles here you're seeing really just to show how the space can accommodate different, like a smaller group of events here. For you see like the thicker black lines with the arrowhead in front, that start to identify where that can be associated with like a seating arrangement and how people can enjoy the people watching. At different extent, you can be more on the stage area, more of a slightly higher point view to look down to the whole park, or you can be more close to the intersection and look back to the park, or you can be more in front of the art museum here that get to enjoy a little bit more of that garden enclosed greenery here. So there are different type of people watching. You can get to enjoy as well. You want to be more fully engaged, or you want to enjoy your moment here. So the diagram here just to show a different extent of the experience in terms of the activity will be accommodated on day to day.
So you can see the different size of bubble. People have a different experience. Each people has their own social size and circle. That's the sort of variety of the size of bubble represent flexibility of the activity and relationship to the social environment. And the goal, what we really want to achieve here is, as we said, inclusive park. Everyone come and do different things. So to accommodate into the different scale and different type of activities is really primary focus for us. And hopefully this represents a little bit more easy to understand how people use, but even one space can be used a different type of programming, different type of scale of activity. And even performance, like the previous one that Misa showed, it's each person has a different relationship with the music and performance. It could be directly really in front of them, or it's much a little bit far away from actually looking over the stage. So the way we sort of providing to the different tier and it has some segment, but it can be one space, those flexibility can be provided different scale and relationship to the place.
Some example, some are already happening within the Congress Square Park. Also, we look into different variety to give people some pop-up experience in terms of they have this mobile library, really popular in New York, that kids can enjoy outdoor reading on a daily basis maybe, and they can utilize this flex space and then have a smaller group of gathering there. From day to day to special, we look into the possibility. What if we start to look between the museum and the Congress Square here and then utilize it as one space? That could happen more like a Sunday street closure. You can have more bigger events. For instance, even for the pumpkin or some like a seasonal event currently only happen within the Congress Square Park, that could be part of the theme can kind of start to spill out to the across the other direction of the street as well. All these pink lines are trying to say that when people are within different point of view from each intersection, they get to actually enjoy the holiday lights that could project to the museum facade here. And so that is really try to think about it is that within the park or within the one a major public space here, or how we look into Congress Square as the one open space, and particularly this is really like a special events that can happen here. Some example here to show for the fall festival, dance class, street farmers market, which we could close the Congress Street side and allow people to move across between the art museum and the Congress Square Park there. Seating. So seating, this one start to kind of peel out from the site plan that we showed earlier and how you know they really relate to the open space and people can move. But this is just to show different type of seating arrangement. You can see some of them might get to have the opportunity to face to each other. Some of them more of the linear, you get to do more of the people watching, either within, like into the park or toward the intersection. And also we identify the potential area that we can utilize the movable chairs to encourage the more of the informal conversation happening on site. Some example here. Whether how that seat wall condition can be really tied into the planting area. Can they be more of different material changes you see in the middle? There's a different way to introduce where you sit, or people. Some people might want to feel like they're comfortable to sit on the concrete. Some people might feel like they want to sit on the wood. So there's just different consideration and things that we're exploring. Definitely these movable tables and chairs, they're so popular and we wanted to make sure we capture the informal informal kind of the social engagement within the park and throughout the Congress Square. Where can we populate these movable chairs within the Congress Square? Water feature here. In a way, we wanted to think about what can we introduce not just a water fountain as you see passively, but it is something more of like an interactive, and that is for all age, people can enjoy it. There's definitely a little bit of the season limitation to it. So when water shuts down, what can we do with the space? So then we recognize that to identify this area would be kind of the ideal, which is surrounded by the landscaped area. When the water shuts down, if kids are playing within the area, there's a visibility to it, but also they're surrounded. So they're not right kind of running to the street directly, but also protected by the landscaped area. And we started to pull that because within the existing park, the current kids, if you remember, they're more of playing toward the back corner there. That is a popular kind of activity, but we recognize we can start to pull that out and then having kids playing more to the central area, but still protected within the landscape here. Here are some example how really we can think about a water feature. That can be these interactive water jets or more of the mist and fog or even like a screen pool, as you call it, like a thin layers of water on the surface. And then it's dropped down to the surface here. So we are not creating any edge to prevent people to get into the zone. And the idea really is that people get to touch it, to play it, and everybody can enjoy it at the same time.
So this way we can shut off in the winter time, it's going back to the paving area. Or summertime, you can use it, the different usage doesn't have to be fountain from there.
The next level, element that we wanted to touch on is the landscape and planting approach. And here is Patrick.
Hello, it's nice to be back. This is a pretty encouraging turnout. For the half dozen faces I don't recognize from last time, I'm Patrick Kalina, work in planting design, which always goes usually at the end.
I know,
tonight's different. It's a special occasion. So, I'm going to touch a little bit upon approach, because what Keiko and Misa have shown you already is essentially kind of a structural and programmatic, the structural and programmatic elements, the bones, the skeleton of how this can all work, and then we start to flesh it out. So in the architecture studio that I'm in, my friends who are architects, not landscape guys, often use the word greenery, which you heard before, and I make them put a dollar in a jar every time they say greenery. Does anybody know what the Pantone color for 2017 is?
Yeah.
It's greenery. So what you see now are these green panels, right? And you see trees sticking out of them. And so there's all different ways that that can become articulated. And so that's what this process is about. And it's essentially hasn't really started yet other than these general kind of propositions. So, one of the things we're exploring, these are all images that were taken in the Portland area or in Cape Elizabeth the last time we were here, is this idea of kind of the concept of a dynamic landscape, which we have all over the East, regardless of our various ecologies, and the sense of ecological sort of rupture and fracture, which can be all different kinds of ways. In this case, it's geologic. It occurs over many, many eras. But you have this sense of this emergent living component that's pushing up through these spaces opportunistically, right? And so you can pull lots of really interesting things out of these dynamic spaces and make them functional in an urban environment. So, and the idea of seasonality is more nuanced than spring, summer, fall, right? You have last time I was here, that's what, on the left-hand side is what Winterberry Holly looked like. And this is what it looked like yesterday. The sense that you have this progression, even within a short period of time, that something else can always engage you if there's enough nuance in the space you're developing. And that stone, that same sort of fractured landscape, which is kind of have such a local character, is also something that can be mined as landscape components. So a lot of what I do are taking plants out of austere, traditionally, like what I would call austere, difficult landscapes, because I'm really more interested in them. How do they do on their worst day versus how do they do on their best day, right? So what are the tolerances of a plant? Because then you know how far you can go. And so on the sandy slope, just a foot and a half above the salt line, you have ironweed in mid-August without irrigation. Beautiful purple foliage is perfect here, and now brought into an urban project in a traffic zone in Boston. And so it's not so much as an argument for native per se, as much as it is an argument for functionality, but something that's also dynamic and beautiful. So the seasonal progression is all around us. If we just focus on coastal areas or the coastal plain, here's some sections here where the same meadow on the top, left and right, in the summertime, you see little blue stems starting to color up and some late summer goldenrod. And now in the fall, all that green sumac turning red. Or in the case below, a little bit more nuanced in the herbaceous level, goldenrod euthamia graminifolia in its yellow form, and then its white seedhead form. So those little things become really interesting, durable plants that are also appropriate, right? And so as we pull further and back into the urban zone, we can have the seasonality work here in these detention basins on the project that we did leading into Brooklyn Botanic Garden. And then here you have that same Emsonia hubricti and panicums in the front turning golden red in the fall. The other things we're trying to do, in addition to just creating landscape spaces, you're talking about creating a functional habitat, not just a habitat for pollinators or birds per se, but also for people. So there's a sense that you are immersed in a living landscape, and hopefully those impressions that you make are impressions that you're making on families or on children, and you're kind of extending this impression of what is possible in the natural world and have enough nuance to engage people throughout the year. And the sense that pollinators do live in the cities, in the example of the holly, there are fruit for the fruit-eating birds. In the example of the echinacea, there's seeds for the seed-eating birds. And so it's not just things that feed; it's things that are part of a cycle or just used for shelter or habitat. And that that seasonal progression is part of the same show. So what we're starting to talk about now is those green panels. So how much complexity is enough? How much is too much? I think a lot of times that is informed by the physical character of those spaces, how grand they are, how narrow they are, how much light there is. But there are degrees of complexity within any potential project. So you may have something that's a simpler combination on the left, a little mountain mint, butterfly weed, and Emsonia on the left, and then on the right you have sort of this more dynamic grass-driven landscape. And so here's one example of how we started. This is a recent project for the Smithsonian, and we're just starting to think about degrees of sort of the interconnectedness of potential plants and how many is the right combination and how much repetition really helps to drive that story. And so in some cases it may be a simpler combination as it is up top, but where you have more depth you may start to see sort of greater complexity as in that bottom sketch. So when we talk about establishing these things, and so one of the nice things about the herbaceous world is that a key, really keen gardener that I know has this quote that says that gardening is the slowest of the performing arts. And I think that's true if you're gardening with hedges and topiaries and 200-year-old white oaks, which are all interesting in their own way. But I think that one of the advantages of the herbaceous layer is how quickly you can establish something. So in this case, and this is Pete Odolph's planning design for the High Line, and we have in Chelsea, the Chelsea grasslands. On the left-hand side, just the plants laid out one fall, and that middle image is the following summer. Okay, and then the following fall, there it is on the right-hand side. So you can establish this herbaceous component while the other things are developing, as you're going to need time for the trees to establish themselves, is one example. So the nice thing is those landscapes are this, while these are kind of doing their thing over here. Something to entertain you while you're waiting for the next show. And so the seasonality in the deciduous world, what does that really look like? So here's one example. Again, back on the High Line, spent a lot of time selecting gray birch as sort of the predominant plant for that part of the park. And you can see it late summer there, then fall, and then winter. And so this idea of a winter landscape can be evocative without necessarily a bunch of sculpted evergreens to kind of remind you that there's plants there. You have a sense of not just this dynamic evolving space, but you have the sense of this kinetic character, this moving element that, you know, as grasses and other herbaceous plants move with the wind, et cetera. A project that Keiko and I worked on in Bethlehem Steel, the Hoover Mason Trestle. This is just fairly recent, only about a year and a half old. And so you, you have a sense really in the early days of how quickly we're able to establish some of these plants. And this is just 1 year, you know, in that in the southern end of the zone from very small plants and plugs, you know, enough of a show to kind of let people know that there's a dynamic process in play. But the byproduct of that, you don't always expect every outcome, right? So this is a really interesting thing. So the woman on the left-hand side is a woman named Ilsa. She is, do not be fooled by the age, she is a formidable lady. And she essentially, while the project was still in its sort of construction contract phase, when it was hands-off and the contractors take care of it, we'd started to get in, and I got a couple of notes from people saying that they'd be interested in participating in a volunteer capacity. And so she has essentially marshaled volunteers to go in and take over, and she sends emails kind of asking for plant lists and we did plant walks and talking about what goes in next. And so that completely organically, that space, which is not even a park, you know, it's kind of it's a municipal landscape on a bridge in Bethlehem Steel, has become this participatory experience for part of that community. And that really helps drive a lot of the messaging going forward as people start to realize that, you know, these things are not no maintenance. You don't put them in like a painting and step away. You know, it is something that has to be engaged over time. So it's lower maintenance than a traditional landscape, but not no maintenance, right? So this is from an article that the local paper did about these volunteers who really jumped in to save the day. Another example of a quick establishment on a lower budget, and you know, on the lowest budget of the ones that I've showed you. This is a redesign of a section of the Rose Kennedy Greenway in Boston, which is the roof of the Big Dig Tunnel. On the left-hand side, that's in the spring, and then the following year, summer, looked like that. We're holding its own against traffic, and on the inside, enough of a barrier with a lot of seasonality, that's just spring and fall, for people to be engaged. And then they continued this process on to a bunch of sort of other failed parcels where things had become overrun, right? So there's enough seasonality there that the same section on the top left and the top right is just a season apart, okay? And and they've extended this now to other blocks. So the concept being that this sort of interwoven, again, this is more complexity than you may end up seeing, but the concept is that there's enough of an interwoven character there that if you lose any one thread, you don't lose the garment. You know, nothing is hanging on one large component to be successful. Okay?
Yeah, so as you can see here, the green, that's when you need to kind of like grab all that texture and the layers around what Patrick just shared, and then to underneath all the tree canopy area here. So we're showing green just really a conceptual way. We're not saying these are just flat green. That definitely needs more of that dimension to come in a later phase here.
One of the things you're always looking for too in an urban project are opportunities for permeability or perforating this panel of different streets and plazas and where the opportunities to just cut in. And there are more, you know, there are potentially more than you're even looking at here. I mean, I think this is sort of a placeholder for other things that you can, you know, any of those spaces can grow or shrink or.
And more likely we're expecting to sort of extend the idea. The previous diagram we showed, the blue line, which is actually extension of the Congress Square, it has a starting experience to filling the using the planting or paving material. So you can see a feeling of the Congress Square and sort of character that the Congress Square has. And the planting is one of the big elements of that, because it's almost leading off. and all elements, the seating and lighting and planting, and obviously we have public art piece and the significant art piece as well. All of them is netting each other as art. Everything could be art, and this, the site itself, it is the art. And that's sort of a goal to create the one piece, holistic sort of approach and elements and art and collaboration, it can be create the one piece art in the Congress Square.
We have a question.
Okay.
All right.
So.
Thank you so much. I had a question about the decision with respect to the stage. You didn't go into your thought process so much on that.
So I think the jury, the question was
about the thought process in terms of where we start to citing the stage would be. It definitely came out from the process that back in the October, the workshop, we look into where would be the most location where it oriented to, in a way you can accommodate a variety of size of the crowd and where people will perform. As currently located, it's more of toward.
Correct.
So you have actually shorter, like a shallower depth in order like people in front of it and spread out more of like a wider location. We look into different, more of like toward inner to tucked in. One way is to utilize the corner, almost provide a backdrop here, and that it was people perform and they face into the intersection here. So the idea is really coming, using that also to elevate the stage and then to give that space a slight visibility. So in a way, it's double duties that we try to, in a way, to tell people you kind of don't want to do something that's not welcoming because people can see you. And so that corner wouldn't become a hidden corner as you would see is currently somehow it could, you know, happen as a corner there. So then the stage, it's really coming through this different way, the viewpoint, and then how they can accommodate variety size of the performance here.
And so I think when we are talking about park, the stage here might be the one location, because here is people kind of looking in this way. While we sort of during the workshop and conversation, we want to extend the experience to cross the street as well. Where is the best place? We exercise a couple of different spaces, the more likely this end up to the best place to extending a sort of the viewer to cross the street, because that's one of the sort of method we can do unified intersection as one if there are big event going on.
Just a follow-up thought, if you will. So I don't know if it's a good idea or a bad idea, but it means that I'll have my back on the traffic.
Which I think these some of the islands will give you a sense of the backdrop for the people who standing in the space as well. So this will be your view. This is almost like a front row from the VIP stage here. You do the next stage here, and then we do have these islands around you.
Yeah.
The idea to extend to here is that sometimes people want to know what's going on, not necessarily want to be right in there. So these definitely give you opportunity to almost like understanding but not fully engage or participate through what's going on there. But definitely that's something we can think about how to utilize even the planting or some of the height of the planting area to give people a sense of surrounding. You're not having, you know, the fear that the car is really run through. And also there's a certain distance from where people stand to the traffic area too. Yeah.
Three quick things. Where are we going to put the bike racks? That's just, I always ask that. So think about that.
Yeah.
Does the hotel cafe disappear, or is the hotel okay with that? Where is that?
So we do kind of anticipate certain area, but not fully dedicated only, but we do allow.
And then a snow plan, because
yes.
Parking, plowing through the park is going to be.
So generally, we have a clear lines to provide the small plow can go through, so the plow it can be happening, as well as we don't have any steps, so the plow can come in, go through, coming in and sort of every location if you need it, culture coming to take out the snow. So we still have to exercise where actually store the snow and those kind of things. How much did you need it? And that's, yes, one of the few that we definitely will do.
Yes.
I also have three quick questions. One, there are some activities like swing dance and jazz dance that really don't want to happen on concrete. Is there a provision to perhaps have a sprung floor or a heavy marley that gets rolled out? Have you thought about that storage? Right. Second, you talked about shutting down traffic, which I applaud. I don't know if you're imagining both Congress Street and High Street, but have you thought? That would be ambitious, I know. But even for just Congress or just High, have you thought about the alternate routes so that there's an agreed upon plan? Right now, it's a huge process to get that street closed. It'd be very, very nice to have a much simpler process. And finally, I'm interested in how you modulate the flow of traffic and people. Do you first get a chance to cross High Street and then Congress or whatever? In New York, at one point, we had the Barnes Dance. With the Barnes Dance, you could go in. All the streets were open for crossing at once, and then all the streets were closed, and the cars would go again. And the cars didn't all go in both directions. Have you thought about that modulation?
Should we bring in the secret weapon?
Okay. That was a good concept. We've not evaluated, but that's an interesting one. But we are engaging discussions with the Department of Transportation about what we can and cannot do. And we do have some suggestions or some ideas about actually diverting traffic. I'd like to see us talk a little bit about diverting traffic from the bridge, Casco Bay Bridge, that determined to go to 295 away from High Street. But that's an exercise, and also the other issue that we have, and I think the city has a program now too about signalization, and there are ways to encourage or discourage traffic movements and patterns by the timing of the signals. So there's some things that we have, you know, that we're talking about that will come to pass, I think, as this project evolves. But you have some interesting ideas. Thank you.
Just quickly to catch that dense floor thing. I mean, as currently they do have the dense floor, like a 12 by 22 that I mentioned. So for this area, definitely accommodate minimum three would happen in that area here. So we anticipate to continue to use the same method just for people to be able to dance heavily. Yeah.
With this design, how many, what's the maximum capacity you would anticipate for people to fill the square?
The question is, how many, what's the physical capacity, number of people that can be accommodated by the space?
We haven't done an actual calculation, in a way. We definitely have more
but
than
no less than.
Yeah, more than amount of surface what currently park has. So I would easily say do more people to accommodate, but we can come in back to certain number. We haven't done a calculation.
That design, it looks like it would be less because of all the chits not. It's not more.
Oh, enter it because you're pushing
the hand. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
So some of the earlier thinking had been to look at the architectural confines of the space as the square, not just the area proximate to this building and whatnot, and certainly with the gestures that you're using there with the planting and whatnot, you're reaching across, and the modification taking up the island there in front of the high
museum
certainly helps. I don't see any real thinking in terms of reaching out materially or anything like that to try and reinforce that, that whole space. Is that going to be an art function? Is it going to be, or, you know, paving? Wunderf's had been talked about earlier on, and really trying to blur those lines between the vehicle and the pedestrian. Any further thinking on that?
We do have thinking of it, and that will be the next layer of it.
We have certainly that in a conversation. It also depends on how street alignment is going to be end up as well. And there are sort of pros and cons to unifying using a surface material, which is we also have to think about safety, which is visually can unify the space, but at the same time you are inviting more people to sort of the street side. So we are carefully exercising those pros and cons, and definitely material is a big portion to unify the, this surface. And one piece missing right now in terms of this conceptual graphic is sort of the material difference between street side and sidewalk side, how the sidewalk side material is going to be changed from the other place to when you come to the Congress Square area. And that's definitely an important portion to exercise.
Yeah.
It's hard for me to envision how much space is in the middle for bigger events. And one of the things, this is beautiful, and one of the things that kind of works right now with a not as beautiful park is that we have movable things so that the planters and that, so if we need a whole big empty area for an event, does any of this move?
So
or,
the
or is it all static?
Planting area, it will not move. However, we have some trees and vegetable elements as a screen, but generally, those planting is lower than your visual. So if there's something happen, for example, here, people standing here still can be engaged to the event. And people standing here suddenly engaged to here, or if something big stage event or performance happening, people jump all the way through to actually engage to the event, what's happening there, and sort of part of the activities. So without moving around, we're going to be careful to sort of choosing planting and species, how actually higher is coming up, without sort of distracting to the connection in between the space. But in that way, when nothing happens, it is still you have a beautiful park, and that's sort of part of the identity. And we would like to make sure as much as the flexibility is accommodated, but without sort of maintaining more or moving around to at the same time, daily days, more or less people can enjoy the space. So it is a balance, and I think we'd still be able to accommodate the same size of the large event in current park is holding it, it can be happening in the same proposed park. But it's not moving around, the planting is not moving around.
Okay, so that the big area in the middle, how does that compare with the square footage that we now have available for large events?
That is roughly about 3,000 or so but I don't know how that translates in terms of, that's the next level we need to study, really, like say for different size of the performance, normally how people will be engaged to it, and then definitely we can make these circles or bubble more of the quantify and to show how many people it can be.
And I think we definitely can bring back the numbers, but one of the things surprised when we went to the park, it actually, it's not really that big, the central surface, because of the surrounding sort of topography and planting. So in a way, we're very confident to what we have in the central piece. It's not much different from what we have in the central. What it does, a new approach, is taking out those buffer around the current surface, people much use and engage to the central piece. So it's going to be like sort of usable space is much larger than what we have in a park right now.
It is.
Yes.
You see a large
all
green
on one
long, okay.
You're seeing a large green presence here. You just imagine all of the things, think about it now, and imagine all the things that have been subtracted. So that big elevated raised bed, the clock room, the stairs down, the kind of the really static edge of the stage with those raised beds. Those aren't necessarily occupiable places. Those have all been pulled out, the way that you move around that back corner. So you get all of this space back that can then be rearticulated into these other uses.
Yeah, I have a couple questions. First, is the line of the sidewalk on Congress Street, is that the same as the current, or is it extending out?
This one here?
Yeah, is that extending out from the current, or?
The bump out did push toward this way to allow more of the sidewalk surface along this here.
It's the same line that it is now, but some of the what's currently on street parking has been removed, so there is more sidewalk on the Congress Street side.
Is the intent to essentially clear everything out and start fresh? You know, to literally take everything out of there and build a whole new.
We have asked the design team to develop a phasing plan for us, but we haven't gotten to that level of...
That wasn't the intent to clear everything out and start fresh.
In a conceptual way, yes, but how it actually gets built out, we don't know.
To rationalize, well, to deal with the changes and all the existing grades and everything, that's an easier...
So with my... Secondary to that is, what is it planned to be brick, or is there some other plan for some other surface treatment?
In a way, is that we do have different options that we can go with, but we sort of don't want to distract ourselves from that aspect. Is that we know if the space can accommodate these programs and activities. Then the next level definitely we look into the material. And material, not only the paving, also the planting material need to come back in. So that definitely we wanted to give a more holistic approach to it. But
we do understand sort of that in a stage when we start exercising the material itself, we come from feet and we have a snow as well. And surface treatment is harsh. And I think here more snow, so I can imagine much more harsh. So the paving material is one of the big items we need to carefully select.
Well, the city requires brick. My question is, the sidewalks are required to be brick, but inside doesn't have to be brick.
Right.
So my question is, are you looking at different, or are you looking at the entire thing being brick? You haven't decided that.
We haven't decided yet.
And just the last, in terms of, if you tear the whole thing out, you could actually put the system in there to heat up the sidewalk, etc., so you wouldn't have to deal with snow plowing. I think if you put a water system in there, you'd have to do something like that because it would freeze and be useless after the first winter. So if you're going to put a water system in there, you're not going to drain it after winter.
That'd be very
difficult to drain that.
Thank you. If you're proposing taking parking spaces out of that area, are you going to make up for them somewhere else?
That's the plan, yeah.
Like in the same neighborhood?
No.
The goal is to be at least net zero, so if we take one or two spaces away on Congress, add them on High or somewhere else. So that's where we're trying to get.
It's really interesting. I like the way you brought the green around the whole intersection. I haven't the faintest idea what you've done with the trees. And I don't... I feel like you've tried to offer us everything, and the park isn't big enough for everything. And several people have mentioned a stage and an audience being able to see. Now the steps, I understand, that park still is accessible. You can go in at the left-hand corner and there's no stairs. But The steps did serve often in an amphitheater effect, which was had, you know, it had some nice points to it. But it just seems to me that realistically, we're going to get some of what you've told us about tonight, but it isn't, it can't all happen in that size of space. Maybe the highest thing I want to know is we're just going to get all these bushes and wildflowers and no more trees?
That's about three times the trees you have now, mm-hmm. right? Just at least conceptually.
Are those trees or bushes?
Those are trees.
Are they all new?
Yeah, this is all reimagined.
So they won't be the same size as what we have now?
No, it's hard to see them at this stage, right? Because you've just seen the crown of a tree. That could be something that is a single trunk, it could be multi-trunk, it could be an ornamental tree, it could be a shade tree. It's just sort of structure.
So you're going to take out what's there?
The understanding is, yeah, that we're going to take out what is existing.
So I have a few concerns. One is the stage being back there. That's a cool idea, and it utilizes the space. But one of the things that I like is that you can sit and watch music, and you can watch the city as well, and be a part of the city, and not have your back to the city, and just commit to that. And I'm just visualizing like you having to go in and committing, or as you're coming in, you're seeing the stage and like the backs of people. And also the visibility of the stage. Sometimes there's just like small performances that a lot of people don't know about. And if it's way back in the corner, I don't know how much it would draw in the crowd. The other thing is if there's the splash thing, I love anything that has to do that's accommodating the kids. I have a young child, but one of the things that I love about Congress Square is that it's, you know, there's a lot of, like, people are out there reading and working and having conversations, and a splash pad's going to draw a lot of noise, which is already a noisy intersection, and you're also going to have to look through that, right? If there's a performance, the splash pad would be in front of that, so I don't know how that would really work out. Being able to see the music, and then also being able to watch it if there's kids on a splash pad. So those all are concerns in my head.
Well, generally from an operations point of view, if there's an event, you turn it off. Like you don't have competing components. So part of the position of the stage, at least conceptually based on the previous discussions, was a retreat from the noise you describe, sort of the traffic noise, and you have a sense of immersion. And if you have a scalable event, you can be closer to the stage with a smaller group and then grow larger as you know, depending on what the draw is, as you move away, and then that enables you to kind of turn things on or off as you need them. But this is, you know, still sort of part of the discussion, but that's just general. The concept is that sort of the friends of the park have to program that space support, you know, in a way that really works on a day-to-day basis, and then all of these different constituencies kind of work together.
Well, there's a lot of pop-up stuff, which is really nice to be able to do last second and last, you know, and just, yeah, it's kind of nice to have that pop-up mentality instead of having to coordinate everything like through the system and shut down the water and that. And just one, before I forget it, I actually really love the sunken in effect because of the children, you know, they're able to just run around and play, and even though it's a really busy area, we all feel secure in there. And so I guess I would just be concerned about losing that. I mean, maybe it wouldn't be lost, how you're envisioning it, but just to kind of plant that seed that it's really nice having the music over here and having that back corner for the kids to run around and play because they're totally secure in there. And you know, we've all been able to kind of like swing dance and also watch our kids over here without them being behind us over where the traffic is. If the music's there, then there's much more potential. There's no little nook for them to kind of dance and run and whatnot.
Thanks. You may have touched on the answer to this, which is that you haven't really looked at paving materials and But I'm looking at, it's basically a traffic question, looking at the hay building sort of almost being an aside, like it doesn't have, you know, crosswalks or a real connection. I do see, you know, a little bit of the same vernacular green-wise, you know, landscape-wise, but I guess I'm just looking, hoping to see that same, you know, sort of across from the museum into the square and to the hay building, all being drawn together as one space, and from a mobility standpoint, from a, you know, person who wants to go from the hay building across, that there would be, you know, a very natural desire line, like, you know, the whole thing would be a big plaza versus like what you sort of shown, it's a very traditional crosswalk. And I know you haven't really articulated all that yet, but I just would love to see the hay building in particular pulled in through the design language. And across the street, obviously it's more challenging to go across High Street, but for that reason, all the more, you know, that we can do to, with, you know, not just traditional crosswalks, but enhanced connections there.
I want to address the stage question a little bit further. This is still, it's hard to probably understand you in terms of how topography works. And we call this a stage, but we also say that one of the things we created the highest point back there is exactly you mentioned, people sit down there and looking back, and which was a really great spot. So nothing going on, people can do that. But it's not just nothing going on in the same way. So this is high, low, 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 going back high. It doesn't mean stage have to be there. It depends on the scale. If it's much more smaller or much more intimidate the performance, people actually can play the jazz here. And the people sit down here and looking back there as well. So there's some sort of flexibility of it. And I understand sort of the people has a different experience in different direction. People wanna see the performance or sit down and sort of engage to the part. And that kind of feedback is very important for us. And we are thinking to the flexibility very, very seriously taking as well. So definitely, yes.
And the other point, like wearing my old program operations hat, I draw the distinction between pop-up and spontaneity, because pop-up is not spontaneous.
That's true.
Pop-up is programmed, and just like a dance is, and just like an event is. So having flexible space that you can creatively articulate, like a gallery, and kind of turn it every which way, kind of conveys to the creativity of the sponsor. And spontaneity is what just occurs in the course of a day in and around the park. So if you have net greater space than you had before, I think it's for the more physical opportunity to have these spontaneous character, and then we can kind of explore what effect that might have is for kids and safety and enclosure and all that.
Just to camp on to the point across there about the hay building connection and whatnot, that sort of gets back to my earlier thought and some earlier discussions about tabling the intersection, bringing it up to pedestrian level. And I think just tying into the gentleman's comment over here, that would make it really attractive for an all-way pedestrian phase, Steve, and signals, and would you know, all of this would reinforce that pedestrian aspect of it.
Well, one area to follow up, Mark, what you just said is one of the things that we are doing, if you haven't picked up on currently, if you're coming westbound on Congress Street, the signal and the stop bar at the signal, if you have to stop at that high, is actually right at the intersection with High. We're going to move that stop bar back to the point where it's actually be about lined up with a hay building. So that whole area from across the park, from the edge of High Street back to the hay building per se, is going to be wide open in terms of no cars are going to be stacked there while they're waiting for the signal to turn. So it's going to, again, reinforce the idea that whole area is a connected part of the intersection. It connects the two edges together. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
I just have some sort of humdrum housekeeping questions.
Is there going to be some kind of a corner or a cavity where, you know, maintenance functions would be kind of hidden away, you know, hoses, sprinkler controls, you know, trash, you know, sweepers, things like that, tools, and also trash cans. I don't know if there's, you're just wonderful design, somebody's just going to plop a bunch of big belly compactors in the middle of it. But also, sadly, smoking is one of the most popular things to do in Portland. And in the park, I don't think it's legal, but it's going to happen. And also on the periphery, it's ubiquitous, unfortunately. So I don't know if you're going to be designing for behaviors that are inevitable.
That's a long list.
I have to say, too early for all those questions.
From my background, that's like catnip to have someone else talk about trash cans. Because anybody who's ever had one plop down in the middle of something that is painful.
Walt Disney said 30 feet, right?
Yeah, exactly. So I think these are all housekeeping items with the Congress Square folks to talk about, which they've already articulated some of the space needs of how big their requirements are for stage material, dance floor, and all that. But the trash thing is also part of that. So it's just like whether or not there is recycling, whether or not there's this municipal marking for the way you articulate trash versus recycling, and who picks that up and when it goes out and all that. So you want to scale it to the capacity of the group that's taken care of. In general, yeah, storage and logistical considerations are huge.
So it's not like underneath the park or behind the slope or anything?
I think potentially. I mean, you don't know what anything is made of yet, but there are lots of different ways to do that.
Storage area is...
We're thinking with that.
That's the corner on the way back. There are a couple of locations we are exercising, but to sort of negotiating with what the size we need to be, but we definitely have an on-site storage area. Yeah. Yes.
Hey. Is there a 3D model anticipated in the near future? Because I think the public would understand the spaces much better.
Yes.
When? Next meeting? No. Not before the contractors come in, but in terms of communicating this idea.
Right, because so the snapshot you're seeing, that's a 3D model in progress. Mm-hmm. So we will continue, like based on today while we're here, we need to start to kind of manipulate. So that is there, but then the next meeting definitely will have more like a revised and updated version to show. And so you can get to see more in the details. So
I'm not talking about a graphic. I'm talking about a three-dimensional model that people can come and look at and understand.
Not a computer model.
Oh, really?
Phone cord.
We have to think about that. But I mean, we definitely sort of we can show actually the sort of experiencing from the eye level, even not necessarily looking down, but to creating a 3D. I mean, digital is not the same with the physical model. I totally fully understand that. I'm from that to make the model with my team. So we have to think about that. But definitely, we need to provide much more visual communication. People can understand the space and size for the next meeting for sure. And
you have thankfully reduced the number of entrances onto Free Street from the current three to one, and as a result, the plaza in front of the art museum is greatly expanded. Can we focus on that area for just a second and talk about how that currently very dead area might be enlivened?
Right. So one of the idea is that to bring the green from the park side to or the connect this between the dialogue between the art museum to the park. So you started to see these islands coming to this way. The same language we're thinking is almost like the energy who will be pulled into the Congress Square. and then continue to, so the between One Longfellow and Monument Square. So you can see these islands, how they travel. One is that based on the movement, desired movement, people might want to just head through the intersection. They might want to have a little bit more of that quiet time in front of the museum here, or more of that area really is facing back to the museum and then more of the enclosed area. So it's a different experience. Definitely this is more of the more garden-based area that you will see, and then here to still maintain the circulation here. In terms of the connection to the Hay building, and the we had the discussion in terms of to bring the tabletop. Perhaps one is the extent here or extend to the intersection, that definitely is still in the conversation. If we have the tabletop, which means that we won't have the curb drop, if people can surface kind of traveling from here to here, then a designated opening perhaps not going to be as shown here. It means we might need to widen up where the start are coming in. That will dictate really how this island will be located. Really from here, what I'm showing is that we're trying to start to kind of populate the idea is that how this green kind of island traveling through the site, and then that kind of almost like a pool in between the park and
so
the
in terms of sort of space wise, right now we feel like it's undefined. It's really undefined, like a dead space, as you mentioned. A reason for why is the site elements, as well as how to sort of the path and sort of the comfort zone people want to sit down, as well as planting, how we sort of lay out the trees and give them canopies, the which way people facing. So in a way, as a conceptual way, what we're creating is also another social pocket. So they have passive going through, but identifying to sort of pocket people comfortably sit down and waiting for people to meet going to the museum, or part of the intersection meeting people is an important factor. So we want to create another social pocket, if that makes sense.
What do you mean by tabletop? You're referring to tabletop?
So the tabletop, what we're saying is that currently if you see the profile, you have the sidewalk, maybe a 6-inch drop, and the road surface, and come back in, so you have the sidewalk and then to the roadway. When you do the tabletop, means you bring up the roadway to the same level as the sidewalk, so there won't be a transition, means you don't need the ADA ramp going down to the roadway, coming back up to the sidewalk. There are some discussion in terms of once we introduce that, pedestrian safety is still a priority, so then some of these bothers might need to be introduced. So there's a pros and cons in terms of how we want to introduce that flush surface between the roadway and the sidewalk, if you will. So that's the tabletop condition.
Is the discussion of the tabletop the whole intersection, or just?
That would be the ideal condition, but we're not sure we'll be able to get there.
I'm just asking.
So we're actually going to transition to the public art topic. I'm told that Sarah is still not here, so which I feel like we're a jinxed or something, right? Because this happened last time too. So David Ramirez from Z Studio is going to present that material for us, and with what time we have left, we'll continue to take questions and comments about both the landscape and the public art. And I just wanted to add, you have some, WRT has some boards on the wall with regards to seating and water elements. If you have specific ideas or preferences, they're inviting you to write comments on those boards. Or again, you can, if you didn't get a chance to ask your question, make sure you write them on the index cards or go online to submit those comments.
My name is Dave Ramirez. I'm a house builder by trade, but I worked for Sarah in her studio for over a decade. And I engineered her pieces. I ran the installs, public and institutions. And so I'm going to talk about her process and coming to her decisions in partnership with the community and in partnership with WRT. So Sarah's initial site visit was last summer. And what struck her most was the idea of a public ownership of this park, the process that she was told was going to include public input, which is rare for a piece of public artwork. Usually it's a proposal. It's either, you know, there's not a public way to interface with that work. It's usually a committee or something. So let's, she notes here, it's a site with a public ownership and envisioned by the public. And that's not just in regards to the artwork, but in the way that the park wants to be utilized by the community, which WRT went over, and which we've gone over with WRT as well. And the other thing that struck her from her visit was that the park had sort of different areas of activity that sort of bled into each other. There wasn't a real delineation that this is now, this is where performances are, this is where people sit to play games, this is where people people watch. Except for the clock. Okay, so from her first meeting, internal talks within the studio was whether there was going to be one sort of monumental piece or a series of pieces, of which Sarah has done, you know, both in combination and on their own as well. When Mike and I came to the public meetings in October, what we took from there and brought back to the studio was that it was that the monument idea was not something that had a lot of support in the community, since there are already parks, the two parks that on either side of the of Congress Square that have the monuments, meaning of, you know, a big sculpture of a soldier over there, or even, you know, the clock tower as an example of that sort of monumental piece. So from the idea of the park having these different areas of activity, she also sort of thought that the piece should also sort of lead out into the park and have different areas, not just one major piece. So after those October meetings, WRT started working on their design and sent those to the studio, where Sarah and her staff in the studio started looking at places to put her this concept of several pieces. Initially, she thought that she wanted to pull people into the park with a series of pieces into that back corner from the entries on Congress Square and High Street. But in our meetings with WRT, we sort of got this idea that the stage was going to be the area in the back corner. So the pieces that Sarah was talking about doing wouldn't work in conjunction or in, you know, even near a stage. So in this idea of changing and working with ideas that we're getting from the community and WRT, Sarah went back to the drawing board to say. So she's talking about three sculptures in three different areas of the park. They're marked on the concept site plan on the back wall. The idea is that these pieces will sort of create a narrative as you move around them and discover them, that you might not even sort of see all of them at the same time or in the same visit. You might see them in different, you might see, you know, in different progressions. And this idea that you're going to be wandering through the park in a way that the WRT design has sort of curved paths from the street into the interior of the park and then back out. So these are the areas that Sarah proposed after moving out from the back corner. We gave just an area of, you know, 4 foot by 8 foot, something like that. That was the initial idea that we gave to WRT. Now the sculptures will not be rectangular squares that are plopped into the landscape. The idea is that not only will you sort of discover them as you wander through the park, but they'll also be integrated into the landscape, both hard and soft landscape, so that it blurs the lines of, you know, where the piece starts and the ends and where the park starts and ends. This is an idea that Sarah has worked with for, you know, close to two decades now, this idea of where the piece starts and ends, and to blur that and to make that part of the story of the piece, microly, and the story of the park. So each sculpture, she has imagined that they will be set in the, you know, these areas where there will be trees, to create these, you know, the trees already sit in green areas that draw you to them in a way, just, you know, as you're walking through the city, that any trees can. They don't have to, but they can. And when you're there, the piece will draw you into a closer, more intimate look at where you are. And it can, the pieces can sort of transport you out of the park, or they can inform the language of the rest of the park as you sort of move from one to the other, or move from the one and out. So, and then that idea that I mentioned, that it's the line is blurred of where the park starts and where the piece is, also blurs the history of the piece, that maybe the piece was there before, I mean, we all know that it wouldn't be, but that the piece was there before the park came up, or that it came up in conjunction with the trees, that it sort of grew out of the landscape. And this idea of contemplating either where you are in the park or what the piece is sort of drawing you into, like taking you experientially out of the park and into the narrative. So the idea that this is what you might see, and in a way that the piece may not be visible from one side of the grove, and that you might have to get closer to see it. Here's more pictures of the High Line, which show that sort of blurring of, you know, the hard part of the hard structures of the park and the landscape, and where sculptures might sort of wind up. You know, if it's in these trees, you have to sort of move closer out of the path to access them. So part of what Sarah does is she takes works that she's worked with before and recently, and sort of integrates them into the new works. And in Venice, the second time she was there, she was given a garden to put work in. And the sculptures, which you'll see the picture, sort of grew out of structures that were already there, this being an old well. And so this idea that you can't really tell what, if this was there before, I mean, or after. This is a temporary piece, so there will not be water bottles in this piece. But, and then this is another way that she draws you towards the space where the sculptures are. See, the rocks are part of the sculpture, and it sort of leads you in a visual trail into the work. The line of the bottles leads you up out of the work and into the hole in the wall. So this idea of there's a story in the piece from beginning to end, or from you know, you can start anywhere you want, and that there's also a story of the piece that relates to the rest of the park. So as you sort of follow your eyes through the piece, you see other parts of the park. And like I mentioned before, you might not necessarily see the other parts of the piece, but as you walk through the park, you may discover them. So the idea that the pieces will become part of the fabric of the park, that if you're walking through, like with any public art, you can ignore it and walk past it to get to where you're going, or you can stop to contemplate, or you can miss it and see it on when you're coming back the other direction. And the idea of the narrative between the pieces. So this is a picture of one of the things she did in Venice, where there were these fake rocks that were in the larger piece at the pavilion that then scattered out throughout the city. So as you're walking through other parts of Venice, you would say, you know, you would visually be connected back to her work in the park. So again, that the piece is sort of intricately designed into the landscaping of the park, so that it feels like it's, so that it feels like it belongs there or has been there, you know, has truly meant to be there, in a way sometimes that statues do not. They feel sort of placed like a trophy. This is Sarah's work at the High Line, where that idea that the piece blends into the landscape, you know, how the structure connects to the ground here is blurred, and the lines of the sculpture pull you up from the sidewalk into the trees and then out into the, you know, out into the skyscrapers. Or it can draw you back in to these intimate squares, which again, you lose focus on everything else and get into the intricacies of the piece. And this piece also sort of was on either side of the path. So in a way it looked, you know, you could look at one side and not the other. You could look at trying to take in both at the same time. They look different if you were coming from the north or from the south. So this is an overview of what she's proposed. So the idea is definitely now that there will be three areas, three distinct sculptures that form a, you know, that form a whole, that form a narrative. So in the park and with the park, amongst themselves, and hopefully, you know, into the community activities and out into the city as well. Yes, and then it's just the points of this narrative that it can form with the landscape, that you can form with your own experience with the sculptures, that the sculptures can create for you.
I assume from what you just presented that there's no concrete concept of what these sculptures would actually be as yet.
There are, but just in the way that some of the WRT design things are sort of left open, we're not committed to anything at this point. We're still waiting. You know, there's still a process, and so obviously Sarah has had ideas from her initial visit last summer that have changed through the past 9 months.
I guess me, and I would say probably lots of people, would like to see what you're working on as a concrete thing.
Yeah. I mean,
are you there yet?
Yeah, Sarah's there, yes. The idea that she showed the pieces from Venice, the works in Venice, I think, are where she's sort of thinking about moving towards. There were these sort of hammocks that were made of string and other materials, obviously not permanent, but they were sort of meant to you know, as symbols of, you know, they were like stretched out canvases. Their seating areas, which is important to this park. Their, you know, hammocks are places where you can rest in the amongst the trees, that kind of thing. Now these are not going to be usable in that way, but that's one of her ideas that she's thinking about.
This is really a question for both the sculptor and the WRT group. I can imagine and I can hope that we were talking before about the plaza around the museum, that the museum would want to ooze into that plaza a little bit, perhaps with the smaller, large temporary sculptures, perhaps with semi-permanent or even permanent sculptures with proper permission, or perhaps with projections and other things. And I wonder how that works in terms of the site design and how that relates to and might work in conjunction with the sculptures that are being put as part of the
Congress Square design. And I haven't talked to Mark, so this is just my imagination.
Right. Well, I mean, I can't speak for the museum for what they might be planning or on how they could work with.
I'm not trying to suggest that they're planning anything. I'm just asking.
Oh, then I'm the wrong person.
Sorry. Space that can comfortably accommodate that.
You know, at the planning discussions, there's a board member there, but I think that
yes.
There were discussions that it would happen, right?
Oh, there's yes.
Yes, and Sarah is not opposed in any way to this idea.
Yes, I'm concerned with what's going to happen to all of the runoff. Are you doing anything to try to capture it so it doesn't end up in the sewer system?
Well, yeah, I mean, I think in a general sense, there's a much larger permeable component than there was before. So you're capturing a substantial amount. I mean, it has been calculated, but that's up to the calculation that we've made.
Yeah, but it's going into the sewer system.
It's going into planting beds before it goes into the sewer system. So it's sort of taken up by the advantage of the permeability approach with water running through the beds is it's taken up by the components within the bed. The more volume of plants there are in the bed, the more root storage there is for that water body. And then anything inaccessible can be taken up by the plants is still filtered by that process before it gets down into the sewer system. So it's a net plus by a big margin to what you have, especially when you consider the entire intersection.
So the notion of the art and the trees and whatnot is very enticing. And that commingling, the spaces that were shown on the site plan are rather slight in those areas, and so there was the discussion of sort of being separated or taken out of the space to an extent and transported, and it's kind of thin. In other words, to do that, so. There's the challenge of having a piece that is observed from a separate location versus being interacted with. And so I guess that's going to be WRT's challenge with Sarah to how to really blur that line and achieve that notion of the tree lawn, in a psychological way. More of an observation than a question.
Yes, I think for both, both of us have to work closely, both of us have a communication as we started, and definitely we need to the step by step. We cannot go one way, we are going this way, and art is going this way. I think the unique about this process is sort of from the beginning, the intent is the site design and art piece going to be coexist in collaboration and create as a one piece, and hopefully we are in the same way and track as well, and then that's going to be the process as well. And we certainly, yes, recognize that that's a challenge, but that's uniqueness. We have to achieve that through collaboration. And that's the way we can create a sort of coexisting one piece.
I guess a little bit of a second, not follow-up necessarily, but this gets back to sort of the whole outdoor room and sculptural aspects and three-dimensional elements, and it made me think about lighting. And if there's been thinking, because that's an element that's very visible, not just because of the light, but because of the scale and the size and whatnot. And that could be an artistic element that would help, and a unifying element that would separate that space from the normal standard acorn streetlights that we've got. You know what I'm saying? You come into that and everything starts to change, the vocabulary changes.
Yeah. Certainly there's two points. Your first point, this is a rare instance where there's feedback from the public and feedback from a design team with the overall park into how the sculpture either works in the park or what it should be, and which Sarah has welcomed that input, which is why it's not, we can't say this is what it is now. As we get closer, of course, we'll the same way that there'll be, you know, possibly models, there will be, you know, materials and other sort of more, you know, more specifically conceptual images to what the piece will look like in the park and, you know, in its in and of itself.
In the spring?
I guess that, I think that is the idea, that all of this is spring 2017, though, right? The design meetings, yes?
The next public meeting will be February 2017, so that time still is a public engagement. It's not a final presentation. So by that time, we will get to the next level of the detail, and definitely we need to absorb the feedback for the next round, and
there will be more formalized on this.
Right. And sorry for the second point. Lighting has always been important to Sarah. But again, we're not sort of at the stage yet to say there should be a lamp here, there should be a light here, or whether the pieces will light themselves, you know. So
I guess if I just have another comment, it seems to me that it remains to be seen the level of collaboration between the landscape architect and the artist. We don't have Sarah here, so we're not hearing from her directly. But the imagery presented doesn't reflect communication, obviously, yet. So I think the challenge is between now and February to be more convincing that there's actual dialogue going on between the two parties so that it's a true collaboration. It seems like you've exchanged plans back and forth to find the location for art, but that doesn't seem to me to be a sufficient collaborative effort. I don't know if you're on the right same towns together or not, but there needs to be a coming together that's convincing in February with some tangible ideas about what the art is and how it relates to the design, because I'm just not finding it tonight. And I'm sorry she's not here, but also I'm not seeing it in the material in a way that is convincing that there is a communicative dialogue going on. So I implore you to do that between now and then so that we gain some confidence.
Sarah has seen and received all the images that WRT have, like you've said, the plants and what have you.
I'm looking for something to inform us that there's a conversation, a substantive artistic conversation going on. Not yet, but I haven't seen it.
So when you refer to the Venice Garden, and you showed us some images, I have no idea. It looked like three ceramic bottles and then a round thing that looked like almost a green Santa Claus carrying a bag. I don't know. I mean, that's what it looked like to me. I don't know what the material is. I don't know really what the hell the sculpture was. So can you find that a little more?
Well, Sarah's work has always used the wherever the piece is going and the sort of vernacular of everyday objects, things that you whether it's unclear whether it's not that it's garbage, but that it is a piece of art or not. You know, she doesn't use found objects. It's not that kind of thing. It's taking objects that are something else and combining them in a way that it creates, you know, the work and a narrative for the space. They don't just sit on a wall or on a table. They sort of move you from the grass into the well, up the wall, in the hole. And it's true that you might not necessarily know what is actually the art. I believe it was a hole in the wall that was there, not a mirror or anything nothing that she created either. And the well certainly was not. The well has been there for 800 years. It's empty now, but yes. Oh, sorry. Yes, it was Venice. Sarah had the American Pavilion 4 years ago, and then she was invited back to do this work in the garden last summer.
Can we plan to Skype Sarah in next time? She has another transportation issue.
7:30. We could take a couple more questions if people want to stick around, but I don't want to hold people up, or people could come and speak directly to our consultants. I do want to thank the Westin again and CTN. Thank you all for your time. And thank you to our consultants as well for being here. If you're not already on my email list, please add your name to the list so that I can keep you informed about the next meetings. And we will be posting the materials online if you want to add comments or questions there as well.